citizens before the Honorable, the Supreme Court of Texas, are admonished to draw near and give their attention, for the court is now sitting. God save the state of Texas, this Honorable Court.
Please be seated. We'll hear argument in two cases this morning. First is 21-49, Pape Partners versus DRR Family Properties. McLennan County and the 10th Court of Appeals District. And then 2262, Gabriel Investment Group versus the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission. A certified question from the United States Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit. This court has allotted 20 minutes per side in both cases. I will take a brief recess between them. The arguments are being webcast live on YouTube this morning. It should be available in the archives later. You're ready to hear it in 21-59.
May it please the court, Mr. Sequels will present argument for petitioners. Ms. Billings-Ray will present argument for the amicus. Petitioners have reserved 5 minutes for rebuttal. Mr. Sequels will open with the first 10 minutes and will present the rebuttal.
May it please the court, opposing counsel. Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Gunnar Sequist. I am here on behalf of the petitioners, and although it's spelled P-A-P-E, it is Pape Partners Limited. And so, Your Honors, this is a property case. The Texas courts have recognized that a surface water right, once vested, is a private property right, and therefore may be conveyed just like any other private property right in Texas. And just like any other private property right in Texas, it can be the subject of a dispute. And that dispute is what we are here about today in terms of determining the proper forum for disputes over property rights involving surface water rights. The water rights at issue in this case were adjudicated over 30 years ago in a district court proceeding before the Court of Milam County pursuant to the Water Rights Adjudication Act. Those water rights were awarded via certificate of adjudication to the predecessors in land interest to my clients, Lola and Wesley Robinson, and were vested in the Robinsons by virtue of their beneficial use of those water rights. Since that 1986 award, to the time of selling the farm to my clients, use of those water rights for purposes of irrigating their farm. In 2014, my clients purchased the farm and specifically covenanted for and bargained for the purchase of the water rights, the entirety of that water right, along with their purchase of the farm property. When my clients went, however, to record their purchase of that water right with the TCEQ, which is a ministerial function that TCEQ performs, the agency did a chain of title search and determined that part of that water right may have been conveyed previously to some of the surrounding landowners as part of sales of other parcels from the Robinsons. They therefore notified the surrounding landowners, including the respondent here today, DRR, Family Properties LP, and DRR, and some of the other landowners asserted a competing claim to my client's water right, creating a final title. My clients, therefore, in the McLennan County District Court, filed a suit for a binding.
Was that assertion
It was through filing a change of ownership form of their own, claiming an interest in water rights owned by
with
the TCEQ.
Cubes.
Yes, Your Honor.
Have they asserted any sort of, outside of the TCEQ, any sort of interest?
They have, Your Honor, in terms of in the trial court below, the DRR actually asserted a counterclaim, claiming an easement by right over my client's property to avail themselves of the water right that they're now claiming an interest in. And so we filed this property action in the district court asserting claims of trespass to tribe title, suit to quiet title, claims for declaratory relief, and assertions of adverse possession. Both the district court and the court of appeals erred by finding that our property claims fell within the exclusive jurisdiction of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. So we are here today asking this court to reverse that determination on jurisdiction and remand to the trial court for proceeding on the merits.
Addressing the question, property rights that are created by a statutory scheme that's administered by the agency, or do they somehow pre-exist? This permit?
Your Honor, the water rights themselves do pre-exist the adjudication process. They used to be various permitting. planning regimes prior to the statute in 1967 that was adopted, the Texas Water Rights Adjudication Act. And prior to that time, as I think the state will explain, water rights were sort of general. And so this Water Rights Adjudication Act was enacted specifically for a one-time adjudication of appropriative water rights across the river basins in Texas, so to clear up sort of the jumble of competing rights and claims before that. One of the fundamental pieces of the Water Rights Adjudication Act is for anyone who did not assert a claim at that time, even if they had a prior right, either in common law or via permit, that was extinguished. So going through that process, which was subject to mandatory judicial review, there was an initial proceeding under that statute before the TCEQ, but there was a required judicial review and approval. So the ultimate judgment had to come from the Milam County District Court as it relates to the Brazos River. And that happened in our case in 1986.
And so it was an independent review, right? De novo, not bound by what happened in the agency?
That's absolutely correct, Your Honor. And so...
So if that's right, then how can there be exclusive jurisdiction in the agency?
Well, and Your Honor, there can't be. The only way that there could be, and of course our argument is, the agency didn't have exclusive jurisdiction. In fact, we take the position that because this is an inherently judicial question of property ownership, the courts are the exclusive jurisdiction to determine that question. And so this case not only couldn't be brought in front of TCEQ, it had to be brought in front of the courts, which is where we brought. Of course, the question of exclusive jurisdiction.
It's unlike property in the conventional sense. Do you think it could be eliminated by the legislature without the payment of takings damages? It sort of goes back to my first question. Is it just all derivative of a statute and a regulatory process as opposed to being a property right that would be like my ownership of land?
Well, Your Honor, the courts have always treated a surface water right of this nature as a real property interest.
The statute says you have title, right?
Correct. Okay. To title. And it is a usufructory interest in that the state ultimately retains ownership, but through the water right owner has title to use that appropriated water for their own beneficial purposes in accordance with the terms set out in the water right. So there can be situations, Your Honor, for conservation purposes where those can be reduced if there's not sufficient water or if there are other priorities ahead of that. So I'm not saying that there aren't some situations where for conservation purposes it can be modified, but it is still recognized by the courts as a property right, just like any other, albeit it is a little bit different breed.
Would the elimination of it be a taking?
I think so. Absent some specific statutory authority based on conservation, if you were to just take it without a conservation basis in the statute, and the statute, the Texas Water Code sets out the specific areas where TCEQ can regulate in that respect, but outside of that, and we are not here about that today, to be clear, our Clinton case in no way implicates any of the regulatory functions that TCEQ has in terms of administering water rights, such as determining the amount you can take, determining where it can be taken or where it can be used. Those are not the issues at all. Those are all set in the certificate of adjudication, and we take no issue with any of those points. The only question that we are seeking to have determined here is who owns the right to use that water right to create their property. The way DRR would have the phrase, that right is given, and we claim to be able to target that right, and that's what we're trying to seek a judicial determination on.
Of course, so if Texas owns the right, and then your clients have an equitable, would it be similar to equitable title or an equitable interest? Because Texas has personally allowed to you the form of a permit or a concession.
Well, Your Honor, the state owns all of the water. It is just that these water rights, which have been recognized even at common law for both riparian, you know, property owners on either side, you know, that are above the water, or have an appropriative right, have the right to use that state water for their benefit. And so that's really, you know, it is, in terms, it has been referred to as an easement type, a right akin to an easement for use of the water or a usufructory right, but it is entitled to the right to use that water distinct from the ownership of the water itself, which always remains with the state for the benefit of the public.
You keep referring to the issue as being who has the
sounds to me like he has the rights to the water, which sounds a whole lot like a water rights adjudication. Why isn't it a water rights adjudication?
Your Honor, the water rights adjudication, and this is 5.13, which is really the argument that DRR has as to what grants TCEQ exclusive jurisdiction. Of course, I have to point out on the face of it, 5.013A speaks only in terms of general jurisdiction. It is not an express grant of exclusive jurisdiction, which this court has held is required to overtake or to dispel the courts from inherent judicial functions, such as property ownership. But in terms of why this is not a water rights adjudication, when you look at 5.013, it speaks to 5.13C, says specifically that that statute merely allocates statutory powers among various agencies, and that's in 5.013C. It does not in itself delegate a specific authority. And so in terms of water rights adjudication, what that phrase is referring to is the specific subchapter of Chapter 11 of the Water Code. Chapter 11 is water rights. Subchapter G is water rights adjudication. And so when it says water rights adjudication, it's specifically referencing that process as spelled out in the Water Code. Now, that process as spelled out in the Water Code applies to the one-time adjudication, which happened in 1986. What the Water Code doesn't provide TCEQ any jurisdiction, let alone exclusive jurisdiction, to do is to decide what those property rights, having been adjudicated under the Water Rights Adjudication Act, are then conveyed among private property, to decide how those conveyances, decide issues surrounding ownership subsequent to those conveyances. And that has always been decided by the courts, and that's what we're here to maintain.
103A1 also says water rights adjudication, but also general jurisdiction over enforcement of water rights. What does that mean? Separate apart from water rights adjudication?
Yes, and so TCEQ has several separate enforcement powers. For example, if someone is diverting more than they are entitled to under a certificate of adjudication, then TCEQ can enforce on that basis. If someone is irrigating areas that are not approved to be irrigated, TCEQ can enforce on that. So there are certainly enforcement powers that fall under the general administration of water rights that fit within TCEQ's, again, general jurisdiction. But all of those, Your Honor, I would point out, are supported by not 5013A, but separate legislative delegations setting out that enforcement authority specifically in the Water Code. And so 5013 is really a summary that allocates, at this time, among the various environmental conservation agencies, those powers. And that's what Subsection C tells us. So, I'm sorry, I see my time has expired.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Seekers.
Thank you.
We'll hear from the commission.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court. The issue here is one of statutory construction. And based on a plain language reading of the Texas Water Code, the TCEQ does not have jurisdiction to determine a private property dispute. The phrase water rights adjudication is a term of art, which has a very specific meaning under Chapter 11, Subchapter G of the Water Code. Section 11.0301 provides that the short name for the act is the Water Rights Adjudication Act, and it references a two-part process that the agency took to issue certificates of adjudication, which includes a de novo review process before the district court. This court considered and affirmed the constitutionality of that in the In Re Upper Guadalupe case in the 80s. But this is not the process at issue here.
That already happened, right?
That happened in 1986. And so as the petitioners pointed out in their brief, the process has been long completed. So to briefly walk the court through the plain language of the Water Code, Section 5.031 grants the TCEQ general jurisdiction over a list of items which relates to an aspect of TCEQ's administration of water rights, of which are all included as components of Chapter 11. And each of those phrases coincides with a more specific grant of authority under the Texas Water Code. Water rights adjudication, as I said, is found under subchapter G of chapter 11, and so you can't give meaning to 5.013 by reading it in isolation. You have to read the statute as a whole. Section 11.001 provides that nothing in the code affects vested private rights to the use of water except to the extent that the Water Rights Adjudication Act might affect those rights. Section 11.001 says that when a court of record renders a judgment or order that affects the title of a water right over which the commission is granted supervision by law, the clerk of the court has to then send a copy of that deed to the TCEQ for recording. And Section 11.040A provides that a permanent water right is an easement that passes with the title to land. So under the water rights adjudication,
is it vested private water right, like maybe well water? Or is this something different because it's a permitted right?
It is considered a vested property right, Your Honor, and they can be bought and sold just as any other property right. Once that certificate of adjudication is issued, it is considered a private property right, and then the dispute is between the parties, the sellers. So, you know, for example, in this case, between the parties here, where there's two competing chains of title, that would be for the judiciary to decide and not the commission.
And would you agree with what was said earlier that this regulatory regime, this permitting regime, arises out of pre-existing common law property rights to use the water?
That's right, Your Honor. It is a long-standing, the history of water rights, you know, dates back to the 1800s. The 1967 Water Rights Adjudication Act was the legislature's effort to reach something that would acknowledge that the commission did not have authority to determine these vested property rights, and so it was this dual system, but it was limited in time. And so once the time is complete and that certificate has been issued, the agency's role becomes one of recordation.
And in those cases where the commission is making those initial determinations, were they looking to common law for guidance on that, or as to who had the rights and that sort of thing?
So they looked to the statute of Chapter 11 at that point. And so if you look even further back to the 1917 Irrigation Act, which, is a long time ago, one of the things, though, that the courts, the reason that act was struck down is because the agency was trying to determine private property rights, and this court said, no, that is unconstitutional. So fast forward a few years, the legislature comes back in and says, okay, we're going to do the 1967 Water Rights Adjudication Act, and when y'all reviewed that act, what you said was the reason that it doesn't violate the separation of powers is because the district court is the one that is reviewing that in de novo review the award of the certificate of adjudication. And I think it's my time to stop because the court has
permission. Any other questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
We'll hear from respondents.
May it please the court, Mr. Flavel will present argument for respondents.
Your Honors, may it please the court. Justice Boyd is right. This case is about what Section 5.013 A1 says. And I'll just read it. The Commission has general jurisdiction over water and water rights, including the issuance of water rights permits, water rights adjudication, cancellation of water rights, and enforcement of water rights. And specifically what the word adjudication means in that section.
Before we get to the word adjudication, yes, if that word general said exclusive, then, you'd have a stronger argument. But how do we get from general jurisdiction to exclusive jurisdiction?
Thank you, Justice Blacklock. The exclusivity of the jurisdiction comes from the pervasive regulatory scheme that embraces this subject matter. Not from an express grant of exclusive jurisdiction.
And is it really pervasive when the statute specifically assigns to a district court, even in the initial determination, which in this case happened a long time ago, that there's de novo consideration in a court. It seems like that's not a pervasive scheme or only the agency is determining the title.
Well, the scope of the scheme, I think, comes from Section 1.03 and from the Conservation Amendment to the Constitution. And what those say, and they track the language almost exactly from the statute to the constitutional provision, is the conservation and development of all the natural resources of the state, including the control and distribution of waters and its rivers and streams, and private ownership of surface water rights implicates control and distribution of state water.
Is it the ownership that implicates those considerations, or is it the use and exercise of that right? So, in other words, could there be a water code that's working on using and exercising that right in accordance with the statutory scheme versus the right itself?
Thank you for that question. I think it all falls under the same heading. TCEQ regulates these rights and the uses that the use of water pursuant to them, and in order to do that, they need to know who the owners are. And in a drought, they need to know who's pump to tell to turn off. And being directly involved in private ownership disputes, as opposed to just being a recording depository, will help them keep those records more accurate.
And it won't that work?
Well, Your Honor, it's our position that the legislature gave it to them. And the TCEQ's, I'm glad you brought up TCEQ's interpretation of this statute, because it's important to note that their interpretation of this statute has not been formally adopted, and so their reading is entitled to consideration as an amicus, but it is not entitled to deference under the state's jurisprudence on that issue. It's got to be formally adopted after.
Is it possible the reason it's not formally adopted is because it went decades without them even thinking that this was even a possibility? Does that cut against the idea that they've had this vast power that they didn't realize?
Well, Your Honor, their jurisdiction depends on the language of the statute. And I'd like to discuss my view on what that is, what adjudication means. On a plain reading of that word, the Code Construction Act and this court's precedent says that we have to give that word its plain and common meaning. You heard amicus say that they think that it's a term of art. It's coterminous with the procedure set out in the DRR. That's their position. Very clear. But nothing in the WRAA itself implies a meaning like quantify the portion initially, okay? The WRAA owes its procedural limits to its structure, not to any specialized use of the word adjudication. It means there what it means everywhere else. The statutes are defined by the words that compose them, not the other way around. In the Bostock case out of the United States Supreme Court is a perfect example of that. I'd like to read some from the majority opinion in that case from Justice Gorsuch. The court in that case was construing the Civil Rights Act in 1964, and specifically its prohibition on sex discrimination. And Justice Gorsuch wrote, "An employer who fires an individual for being homosexual or transgender fires that person for traits or actions that would not have questioned in members of a different sex. Sex plays a necessary and undisguisable role in the decision, exactly what Title VII forbids. Those who adopted the Civil Rights Act might not have anticipated their work would lead to this particular result. Likely they weren't even thinking about many of the act's consequences that have become apparent over the years, including its prohibition against discrimination
on the basis of motherhood or its ban on the sexual harassment of male employees. But the limits of the drafter's imagination supply no reason to ignore the law's demands when the express terms of the statute give us one answer and the extratextual considerations suggest another. It's no contest. Only the written word is the law. And going further, the Pape's interpretation, or excuse me, Pape's interpretation of the statute is not only not compelled, it's not viable. And the reason why is the last adjudication proceeding on the WRAA concluded in 2007. So what they're saying is TCEQ has jurisdiction over a term, a procedure that has been completed for 15 years, and there will never be another proceeding under it again.
It seems like what you're saying, though, is that it was improper for the court in that case, in the original case, to consider this issue at all, even though the statute allows it to do so, because exclusive jurisdiction is in the TCEQ to do water rights adjudication.
I'm not sure I understand the question, but
I'm trying to figure out how the TCEQ can have exclusive jurisdiction to adjudicate water rights if the issue is if the TWRAA says you have to go to court for a de novo review of water rights.
So the agency determination under the WRAA is subject to judicial review, just like in proceeding in TCEQ to determine private ownership disputes would be subject to judicial review.
But it's de novo, it's not.
It is de novo, and the standard in this case, my reading of the statute, would be substantial evidence. The party in this case has raised substantial evidence as a standard as a reason for striking the statute. I'm not so sure that it's before the court. I'm not sure that that's been raised. But that is a distinction. The Poppies and the TCEQ say that the legislature just couldn't have intended this result because we've been doing it in a different way for so long. This court has said, though, that Texas courts do not substitute the words of the statute in order to give effect to what they believe the statute should say. That's an ExxonMobil.
So we've been very consistent, I think, in saying that we're going to apply the statute's words using their common ordinary meaning and not substituting with other words. And I think we completely buy into that, but we have also repeatedly said that we do that within the statutory context. We look at the words within the context in which they are used. Why doesn't the repeated use of the phrase water rights adjudication in Chapter 11 provide context in which we're supposed to determine the meaning of that exact same phrase in Chapter 5?
Well, Your Honor, the WRAA does not rule out adjudication in another sense. It just doesn't mention it. And as I said before, the procedural limitations on that act don't come from any special meaning of the word adjudication. It means to legally decide an issue there, just like it means that same common meaning in 5.03. That's the position. Moving on, TCEQ's jurisdiction over this subject matter is exclusive, pursuant to the pervasive regulatory scheme that embraces it. And let's not forget, by the way, how we got here, that Poppies took their dispute to TCEQ first. They didn't go to court until TCEQ denied their relief. So their position here that they could have gone to court in the first instance is it's not really consistent with the way that they went about trying to get their problem solved. They would surely
didn't the TCEQ tell them to go to court.
The TCEQ told them that they were wrong and then didn't rule on their motion to overturn the executive director's decision.
I thought agency staff told them that the commission had no process for determining property rights.
They did. I think they're incorrect about that, but that's what the Poppies were trying to get them to do.
It's kind of hard to blame the Poppies for them deciding, well, we're going to have to go to courts because the commission tells us they can't decide this.
It's not so much that they shouldn't have gone to court, it's that they went to court too late. They had a 30-day window and they missed it to perfect their appeal to a district court from that agency determination. And that's a jurisdictional bar. So the Poppies would surely agree, I think, that TCEQ has exclusive jurisdiction over the other three subject matters listed in 013A1, permitting, cancellation, and enforcement. The Austin Court of Appeals has said so for permitting, and the Corpus Christi Court has said so for enforcement recently. And I think that the Poppies would agree that exclusive jurisdiction exists for water rights adjudication, so long as that term means what they say. But if it's given a plain interpretation of the word adjudication, then according to them, that jurisdiction disappears. That seems inconsistent. It would be pretty odd if TCEQ had exclusive jurisdiction of all of the matters listed in 013A1, except for water rights adjudication. I think I'm going to be able to give back some time here. In closing, Your Honors, this whole dispute is over. My client's desire to protect what he what it bargained for in 2012 when it bought that land. The Poppies have said in their filings in the agency that it's worth $500,000. And that's what we're, that's the reason that my client is here in this position. And I urge the court to read the statute as the legislature wrote it. Read adjudication to mean adjudication. Precedent in the separation of powers doctrine really, I think, require and demand it. And I thank you all for your kind attention.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Your Honor. In his argument, my opposing counsel has conceded that this is not a case where there is an express grant of jurisdiction. And that's well taken. Not even the court below found that there was an express grant of exclusive jurisdiction. What DRR's position now appears to be is that there is a exclusive jurisdiction in the TCEQ due to a pervasive regulatory scheme. And he cited precisely two sources for that. The first is a constitutional amendment, which doesn't grant any authority to TCEQ. It authorizes the legislature to pass certain laws in regard to environmental conservation. The second is 5.013, which from 5.013C tells us expressly that it is not a legislative delegation. It is merely an allocation of powers that are statutorily delegated elsewhere. And so what is missing from DRR's argument is any legislative delegation, any statutory provision within the Texas Water Code that would allow the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality to make a decision on property rights that are conveyed after they were adjudicated in that original water rights adjudication and proceeding.
If the Commission issued a water rights permit and another permit holder for the same surface area water, I believed that that permit infringed on its permit,
questions, Your Honor, on, well, so first of all, I have to make a distinction between permitting and a certificate of adjudication because those are technically different things under the Water Rights Act. If someone wants to challenge a permit, when someone goes to the TCEQ to apply for a permit, there is a process where others are notified, and then those who want to challenge the issuance of that permit have to go to the TCEQ. But with a certificate of adjudication, once it's adjudicated, it's a piece of paper that's out there. It's a title. It's just like a title to property or to your car or anything else. That gets traded as it is sold. And when it comes to a question of determining who owns that title, to exercise that right, involved therein, that is a question that comes to the courts. And it has to, because there is no process before the TCEQ. And as Justice Busby pointed out correctly, we were told there is no contested case hearing available to you to challenge this decision. And to be clear, there really wasn't a decision because the only thing at issue before the TCEQ was a ministerial reporting function. As Mr. Claudel mentioned, because TCEQ administers water rights, that they do keep a record of who owns it, and they have to have that. But knowing who owns it is very distinct and different from deciding who owns it. And yes, absolutely, TCEQ needs to know, and that's why they have that ministerial recording function. But who decides who owns it has to be this court, because there is no exclusive jurisdiction, either through an express grant, which we say under the court's Amarillo Oil versus Energy Apple Products, in an inherently judicial determination, such as ownership to private property. And this court in Board of Water Engineers versus McMahon over 100 years ago said there is no other function that is so certainly and properly attached to the judiciary than to decide by binding judgment controverted rights to property, which is exactly what we have here.
We have a shot as, why did you go there in the first place?
Your Honor, we tried to get them to correct the reporting issue because on the front end, that would have been the easiest way to fix this. Ultimately, though, they didn't act on our request at all. It was denied as a matter of law. Arguably, we might have been able to take a substantial evidence review of the decision not to change their record, but that doesn't grant us what we need ultimately, which is a determination as to DRR, as well as the other surrounding landowners, that we are, in fact, the owner of this right. And it is a very valuable right. And, Your Honor, you know, I don't know that DRR really bargained for anything, because I don't think they had any idea that they even had a potential claim of this right until they were notified by TCEQ
in 2014.
Absolutely. But the point is that they will have every opportunity to, you know, establish their ownership if they can in the merits of this case when the court hears it as appropriate.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Sequest. The case is submitted.
Rise.